Hello, everyone, and welcome into CrushTheStreet.com. I'm Kenneth Amaduri, and the environment for Bitcoin and cryptocurrency has been shaky considering we've come off the $20,000 high. Now, in hindsight, we're up 10x from January of 2017, but being that we're down, a lot of people are wondering where we are going from here. And I have on the line someone who got us into Bitcoin. I mean, he encouraged us early in the year in 2017 to get into Bitcoin, be long Bitcoin, because this is going to be big. And this is Tone Vaes, very popular YouTube channel. His website is libertylifetrail.com. And he covers the markets, Bitcoin, the general equity markets, precious metals, and he's just one of the most popular technical traders out there. And it's a pleasure to catch up with him again and discuss what is going on now at the end of February 2018. Tone, thanks for coming on Crush the Street with me today.
Thanks, Ken. I'm glad to be back on the show.
Tone, well, in hindsight, we are here at the end of February in 2018, and we're looking back, and you've done an incredible job of anticipating Bitcoin's ascent, essentially every step of the way up, documenting that with your videos and tweets in 2017, and you know your popularity went through the roof. Now, I just want to start off with, you know, where are we now in this environment of Bitcoin 10,000 after we saw it go to 20?
Sure. Just want to slightly correct you there. I was doing amazingly well in predicting every step of the way, and Bitcoin called the $3,000 high perfectly, the bounce at 1,800, the $5,000 high perfectly, the rebound at 3,000. But then I called 7,500, 7,600, as I expected it to be the high for the year. And I was looking for a correction to 5,000 and then a bit of a stagger. Now, I called a $7,500 top, I also believe pretty perfectly, a little off on the downside, but then this straight upshot to 20,000, that was weird. And that bothered me. And I was trying to predict the price of Bitcoin as we were pumping into 20,000 into the launch of the CME futures on Wall Street. I tried to call that as best I could, but that whole environment seemed very strange to me. I thought that 7,500 should have been the ultimate top. And after we started going down, I was then calling back for 7,500 on the way down. Got caught in one bull trap at 17,500 on the way up. But other than that, I fully expected this correction to 7,500, and we went below that to 6,000. We've now come back, almost hit 12,000, and now we're pulling back again. And I think we're still a little overvalued here. I think this morning we were under 10,000, and I mean, I would like to see it stay above 9,000. Because if it goes below 9, I'm going to have to get more bearish. It's a really weird environment right now, and I think there is definitely a high probability of more downside.
So can you clarify what you mean by bearish? You know, what sort of downside from like a timeline perspective are you talking about? Is it just in the next few months, into the next year, or I mean, what's your overall outlook for Bitcoin going forward in 2018?
It's really hard to actually predict medium term outlooks for Bitcoin because anything can happen. It's such an illiquid environment. Now, my long term outlook for Bitcoin remains very strong. I think the upside for Bitcoin is completely unlimited. And the total downside, like the basically Bitcoin's elimination, the probability of that is very low. Right now, over the next, I would say, 3 to 4 weeks, I would have a better idea if we're looking at a similar style bear market like we had in 2014, when Bitcoin hit $1,300, not 13, but we topped at about 1,240 on Mt. Gox, which is no longer with us. Other exchanges made it to about 1,100 and change. And that was in November, December of 2013. And everyone thought it's a new paradigm and every business is going to adopt Bitcoin. And the next thing you know, we spend a year and a half going down until we bottomed out a year and a half later, or like more like 14 months later, in at around $150. So we actually fell close to 90%, and it took over a year to get there. I think if we don't rebound off of the like the $85,000-$9,000 area and get back to $13,000 in the next month or two, then there is a decent probability that we can spend going down into the summer, and it is possible we can go below 6,000. People think that's unthinkable, but I just try to take them back to 2014, where people thought it was also unthinkable for us to go below 500, and we hit 150.
Yeah. Well, and it's interesting what you said. When prices are going up, there's a euphoria and there's a thriving environment for a certain sector. And it's kind of overly thriving in a way. And I guess the opposite is true. And when you prices go down, there's an equal and opposite bear market, a disastrous environment that can sweep the space as well. And I would almost, you know, compare it to the 2011 to, depending on when you want to call this bear market, 2015 bear market with precious metals. You know, as precious metals have been going down, even since then, it's not like gold and silver have been in this thriving bull market. We've come up, and then in 2016 with gold, only to be teased for it to go back down in 2017. And here we are again in the $1,300 range. So I'm just wondering, you know, what sort of bear market could enter the Bitcoin space, and how, I guess, disastrous could it be for sentiment?
Just short term. So the one critical difference between precious metals and Bitcoin that I've noticed is that Bitcoin tends to do everything at least three times faster. So the bear market in gold, we topped around towards the second half of 2011. We topped at about $1,930 or so, and then we bottomed at just above 1,000. At the end of 2015. So that took about 4 years, which makes sense, right? Because that's similar to the bear market in Bitcoin in 2014, which lasted about 14 to 15 months. So it's about the same, with Bitcoin being three times faster, which is good, right? Because the bear sentiment will turn back into another awesome euphoria. The one thing I would caution, I know you probably have a lot of gold people listening to your podcast. Well, you have to be careful with the current gold rise into 2018. The current gold rise, I believe we started rising around November, and we're still kind of rising back to 1300, this $1,000 rise in gold. Keep in mind that the US dollar has significantly devalued during this time, and the euro has gone up and other currencies have gone up. And because gold is priced in US dollars, I personally attribute the entire rise of gold in the last, you know, 3 to 4 months to the you know, the falling of the US dollar. Like, in order to consider gold to be really rising, it has to rise across all currencies. So if you're not looking at gold in foreign currencies that are rising against the dollar and see how it's doing there, you have to be really careful with the current rise in the gold price.
Sure. No, that's a good point, Tone. Talking about Bitcoin right now, is it different than, let's say, some of the other markets? And is it different because maybe it's a brand new vacuum of space that needs to be filled and reflected much higher with the Bitcoin price, as opposed to maybe other markets which have already filled their vacuums and are just trading up and down more or less? Is that a fair way to put Bitcoin in this massive ascent higher?
Kind of, but like I wouldn't really think of it that way. I mean, Bitcoin is just a brand new asset, like an asset the lights of which the world has never seen. Bitcoin has certain properties that no other asset has. My favorite property of Bitcoin is that it's unconfiscatable, unlike any other asset that has ever come before it. It's actually the first asset a human can ever own that is unconfiscatable by a government with guns. And people just haven't fully comprehended the power of this property. Another property of Bitcoin that no other asset has is that it has permissionless value transfer. Again, the world has never, well, gold can kind of be permissionless value transfer, but you have to be in person in order to do it. Bitcoin allows you to do permissionless value transfer globally, and not perfectly anonymously yet, but in the future, in the near future, perhaps fully anonymously. And these are the types of properties that separate Bitcoin from any other asset. And having Bitcoin in your portfolio diversifies your portfolio into this new style of an asset. Now, of course, you're fully familiar with the 1,000 other cryptocurrencies and other competitors like ICOs, but they're not. They don't even come close. All of those other 90% of all those other competitors, they're basically centralized. So they don't have this functionality of unconfiscatability, like Ethereum proved that it's not unconfiscatable because the creators of Ethereum went and reversed a bunch of transactions during the DAO hack a couple of years ago. All of these ICOs, they're basically unlicensed, unregistered securities, and they can go away any minute. And they're being built on top of Ethereum, which I find to be inferior and technically unstable technology. So as far as I'm concerned, Bitcoin doesn't really have any real competition. And it doesn't really matter how low it goes because the price got pumped. It will be back, and it will be back even stronger.
So, Tone, in any way, has your opinion or view of Bitcoin evolved over the last year or even over the last few months as just the timeline in Bitcoin moves so fast? And in any respect?
I mean, I'm more confident in the stability of Bitcoin as a technology now than I was a year ago or any time earlier. I think Bitcoin is only becoming stronger. The fact that it wasn't easy for us to, I mean, it was a struggle getting the coding upgrade of segregated witness into the code, but it was badly needed in order to build a second layer scaling solutions. And those second layer scaling solutions known as Lightning, they're coming about faster than I even anticipated. People are already using them in production for scalability. And it's only a matter of time before Bitcoin could do close to infinite amount of transactions per second. Fungibility for more anonymity tools are coming. Mining is hopefully, it looks like the bigger players are getting into the mining game. Traditional companies like AMD and other chip manufacturers are now looking into it. And I really like where the technology is going. It's almost like asking someone, hey, what do you think of the internet in 1997 compared to 1996? And the answer is, well, I only have more confidence that the internet is going to be with us for a long time. And that's how I feel about Bitcoin. I only have more confidence in the underlying technological layer, that it's more stable and less buggy and more capable of scaling than I did a year ago.
Yeah, it's a true example of something that is anti-fragile or resilient. And we've been seeing that time and time again. And yeah, we're watching it with our own eyes. I appreciate that a lot. So having said that, I remember prior to the August fork last year, a lot of people were worried about Bitcoin getting split into two. That was a real concern. Like, I don't know what's going to happen to Bitcoin if we have this happen to us. Sure enough, Bitcoin got through that and is stronger than ever. And I guess that goes to your point that you were just saying. So having said that, is there anything now that concerns you about Bitcoin's future? Do you see anything that could derail it as bullish as you are and as confident as you are in the technology?
I mean, anything can happen, but I think it's less. I think a lot of the bad actors that wanted to split Bitcoin into two, I mean, they tried splitting Bitcoin into two. There is, you know, a clone of Bitcoin out there. And it's good that all those people are, you know, out of Bitcoin and they're over there on Bcash pretending to be Bitcoin. So the problem is, the only problem with Bitcoin is the perception and the branding, basically. Look, Bitcoin is not a company. Bitcoin doesn't have a CEO. Bitcoin doesn't have a PR department. I mean, it doesn't have anyone. It has people like me that are trying to explain what it is and promote it. And every, like 98, 99% of the crypto world just wants to demonize Bitcoin in order to promote their own alternative to Bitcoin so they can become personally rich. And this is a problem that I'm dealing with, it's a community problem because everyone thinks they've built something better instead of just contributing to Bitcoin and trying to make Bitcoin better. So it's one of the things that's probably keeping Bitcoin down a little bit is that everyone is trying to demonize it and talk about how bad it is and how slow it is and how they've built a better alternative. But their alternative is totally centralized. It's not what Bitcoin was meant to be. So, I mean, people will get scammed. A lot of people will get scammed. A lot of people will lose all of their investments if they think that they've discovered something better and they're not listening to people that, you know, actually building this technology.
Tone, you were in this early and, you know, it's a testament to yourself and you're living and you get to enjoy the positive consequences because you've made great decisions with your money in regards to Bitcoin. But going down the line here, what is your goal? What's the end game look like for you being positioned in Bitcoin?
I honestly don't know. It's just everything is just happening so fast. And like you said, my popularity on the internet with my YouTube videos, my Twitter channel, it's hard. I'm just trying to continue being this content creator and trying to reply to a lot of my followers. A year ago, I probably had 1,000 or 2,000 Twitter followers. Now I'm over 125,000. My YouTube channel is only about 15 months old, though I have been around YouTube on other people's channels. So for me personally, I'm just trying to keep up with the day-to-day price movements of Bitcoin and trying to keep my followers in the loop. And even though even very recently, I've been pretty bearish on Bitcoin, I still try to, you know, provide this comfort to my followers that if you're a holder of Bitcoin like I am, I mean, it's not that much to worry about. It will rebound. So I try to wear multiple hats. I try to provide responsible trading advice and educate people on how to be traders because they don't have the experience. So many people are in crypto trying to trade with absolutely no real trading experience. This is why I have my trading seminars around the world. I actually did 3 of them this month. And trying to educate people on trading, I try to explain to people that I'm a long-term holder of Bitcoin. And at the same time, I'm trying to speak at as many conferences as I can, trying to explain why Bitcoin is different than all these ICOs, why you should never invest in any ICOs, why it's all just a massive dot-com style bubble, all of these ICOs, and why all of these altcoins are grossly inferior to Bitcoin. And for now, there is so much work to be done in that realm that I'm not even thinking about what's next until after the massive ICO bubble has played out.
Wow. Yeah, I think that is coming. And as long as Bitcoin keeps doing what it's doing, and I got a lot of confidence it's going to continue on, I believe a lot of those funds will go into Bitcoin. I actually think a lot of that money will go into precious metals too, because I feel like to a certain extent, it's the same sort of investor getting into some of these different cryptocurrencies that would have invested in precious metals. Would you agree with that?
Probably. Probably, but, well, sort of, right? So as far as Bitcoin is concerned, perhaps, but people are loving this crypto space because of the high volatility. And the stock market is also providing that high volatility. I would more equate the average investor in these ICOs and cryptocurrencies more as someone that would be interested in penny stock trading, or someone that would be interested in like triple bull, triple bear, like ETFs. So not a lot of these people are holders. If you're a holder of Bitcoin and you're not actively trading, then sure. But I'm constantly around so many people that are actively trading the crypto space, and I equate them more to traders of penny stocks. Mm-hmm. And there are some very good similarities between what's happening right now in the altcoin and ICO space with what happened during the dot-com bubble. One of the reasons why the dot-com bubble got so far out of control, I believe, is because of companies like E-Trade and Scottrade. And you remember all those commercials from the late 90s with the E-Trade baby.
Sure.
And all those other ones, right?
Mm-hmm.
And because of that, the average person from their house all of a sudden became a trader, because they had the tools and the resources to just open an account with E-Trade and start trading. They still needed to be 18 years old. They still needed a bank account. There was some restrictions on their trading, but in general, this is how your taxi driver and your shoe salesman and anyone else was, you know, talking about the latest IPO. That kind of technological advancement is back, because now you don't even need an age restriction. You can be 12, 13 years old. You don't, there's no KYC AML, which is good or bad, depends on how you look at it. There is no financial restrictions. If you have, you know, $300 to your name, you can go ahead. No bank account, go ahead. Anyone can become a trader, literally anyone. Anyone that knows how to use the internet can now become a trader. And I think that is what's fueling this bubble in the altcoins and crypto space, because there's access to this gambling side that hasn't existed before.
Right, right. Yeah, and to be fair, the stereotypical signs were out there when Bitcoin and a lot of these altcoins were hitting their peak. You have the taxi cab drivers, the Uber drivers. I was hearing landscapers asking me about, you know, Bitcoin and different cryptocurrencies. A lot of these bells were ringing, and it correlated with this correction. I don't want to say this is the end, because I don't believe that, but it did correlate with this massive correction that we've seen throughout the crypto space. So Tone, I want to conclude this interview here. I want to thank you for coming on Crush the Street, and I want to give you an opportunity here to share some closing thoughts as we go forward in 2018. And of course, let everyone know about your website, what you do, maybe where you're speaking next, and how they can get more information from you.
Sure. Well, I don't really have any closing thoughts. I kind of said everything.
We really did. Yeah, we got through a lot.
Point. Sorry, say again?
No, I was just saying we really did get through a lot of good content there.
I just don't have anything else to add other than I understand that Bitcoin might be boring for some people at this point when you're looking at all of these Bitcoin alternatives and copycats, but please do your research, understand what you're buying, and check it out. I used to do a podcast called Crypto Scam. I haven't done any episodes in like 6 months plus, but check out the old episodes of Crypto Scam where I covered things like Ethereum and Ripple and Dash and some of the other ones where you have to watch it and you have to understand why you should never put any money into them, no matter how much they're actually pumping. And at the same time, please take a look at why Bitcoin is so important as this fintech technology that is going to revolutionize the way people what people consider an asset and what people are considering a really valuable asset that is unconfiscatable and allows you this permissionless value transfer. So that's all I really ask of people. In order to look for my work, just find me on YouTube. My YouTube channel is just under my name, Tone Vase. Same thing with my Twitter handle. My Twitter is also Tone Vase. My website is libertylifetrail.com. I use it more as an educational site. I haven't had time to publish too many articles lately. There is a very good learn trading section under the educational tab in the menu. And I've started doing my trading seminars where I teach people the basics of technical analysis and technical trading. I do those. It's a full day seminar. In the last 2 weeks, I've done them in LA, DC, and there's one coming up in New York, but that's like tomorrow. So, but after that, I'll probably do them also on other parts of the US in April. Probably Vancouver, San Francisco, Austin, Miami, perhaps. I'm trying to cover as many as I can. And then September, I'll be in Europe. And I'm still working on which conferences are better for me to speak at. But I do usually have a calendar on my website, need to update it. And people can just spot me if I'm ever in their country or their city and try to attend an event or just watch me on YouTube.
Well, you're the man, Tone. Tone Vaze, everyone. Tone, thanks for coming on CrushTheStreet.com.
Oh, thank you, Ken.